Thank you to the audience sitting out here. It's good to find so many of you here, and I know that you've stayed back because you really love the subject. We love our city, we love literature, and that is why we are here. Is the mic loud enough?
Yes.
Right. So in this session, we are going to talk about something a little different from the kind of literature sessions that we have. This is to do with topography, with landscape. Topography connects with literature. And as we know, when we read a book, when we read fiction, then it's a writer who belongs to a certain place. He belongs to a certain place, he grows out of it, he has certain life experiences which are narrated in his book. So the temporospatial element of a book, am I sounding like a teacher? I don't think, I am one, never mind. So it is the spatial element that attracts us to a book, and when we put the book down, what remains in our mind is something about the story other than the characters. We remember the place, we remember nature, we remember the lake, we remember the trees, the mountains, the breeze, and so on. In this session, we are very lucky to have two very well-known people, very well-known individuals who have already been introduced to you, but we know them already. But in between, as we talk, we are going to talk about their works from time to time, so that you remember what Raja Bhaseen on my right and what Rajneesh Wathas on my left have been doing for their respective cities. Let me begin with Rajneesh first, because from the plains we go to the hills. Rajneesh, I'm not going to let you talk right away. I'm going to do a little bit of more talking. So Rajneesh has been in Chandigarh for a long time, and I have known him since his, not his Langotia days, but a little after that. And he was the principal of the College of Architecture. Very well, very, very much a literary person. In fact, at one time he was even the vice chairman of the Chandigarh Literary Society. And that's when I realized that this man from architecture knows not just brick and mortar, he also knows literature. His middles, we've all been reading, we've all been talking about them, and we've all been laughing at them. They are a fun read all the time. And as a conversationalist also, Rajneesh is a delight. Of course, sometimes he can drive you up a wall, but I'm sure today he'll be at his very best. So we have Rajneesh talking about Chandigarh. Now, why is he talking about Chandigarh? Because he's done so much work in Chandigarh. Not just taught architecture, but he's also written books about Chandigarh. And in particular, the first book which I really liked was one on trees, the trees of Chandigarh. And there he said, you know, a line which I'll never forget. Poems are made by fools like me, but only God can make a tree. Poems are made by fools like me, but only God can make a tree. That's what Rajneesh said. He was quoting somebody else, but he writes very well. Yeah. So, Rajneesh, we are going to start with you. And before I ask him to speak about his work and about his relationship with this city, let's see if I can put in, let's see if I can squeeze in a little poem on Chandigarh. Do I have a receptive audience?
Yes.
Short poem on Chandigarh. Okay, this is the Song of the City Beautiful. Song of the City Beautiful. In the euphoria of freedom, we know that Chandigarh came up after independence. In the euphoria of freedom, they carved a niche for me. They gave me a home, a spot where I could be. The lower Shivaliks beyond watched with curiosity as they filled up a hollow into a lake to adorn a silver city. And here is the lake, the hollow that they filled up. The city of the mother goddess, the silver city Chandigarh is also the city of Chandi Mai. The city of the mother goddess, the city beautiful, I am Chandigarh. I am yours, yours to love and keep and preserve. Be mine and I'll never disappoint you. So this is Chandigarh. This is the city that we love so much. It is the city beautiful. It is something that is part of us now. All right. So with that, I am going to ask Rajneesh to talk about his own contribution to the city. You know, it was JFK who once said, don't ask what your country has done for you. You should ask yourself, what have you done for your country? So I'm going to ask Rajneesh, what is your relationship with the city and what have you done for the city? Rajneesh with us. Give him a hand, folks.
Hello. I'm sure I can be heard. Manju, thank you very much. I plan to spend the next 40 minutes praising you instead of Chandigarh. You have been so kind. Anyway, that was...
That's not allowed, I'm sorry. We'll be interrupted by the Dastan going people.
No, that is only just to pull your leg. I think time is of essence and short. She was rather generous in talking about me. Frankly speaking, all that I've been doing with honesty and passion is to unravel the city's enigmas for the citizens, for my fellow citizens. Because as a new city, it doesn't have too much stories and histories which are normally there in the old cities, you know. There are no killas and palaces, and there are no rajas and no Baj Bahadur or, you know, Rupmati and stories, legends. So we don't have that kind of, you know, local deep history which an older city might have. And I'm sure Raja has many things to tell us. As a new city, it may be short, it's maybe an infant in the lifespan of cities, but there's a lot of story behind the making of the city and the kind of, the creator of the city, the architect himself is if I was a Hollywood David Lean, I would make a biopic on Corbusier more than, on Picasso. There is so much hidden in the nook and corner, on the walls, on the facades, on the skyline of this very, very young city.
Rajneesh, may I interrupt? Which year did you come to Chandigarh?
I came before the open hand.
Before the open hand, when was that made?
I came to the city as a student of architecture in 67. Studied for 5 years.
And it bowled you over completely. Tell us why.
You see,
or did it grow on you?
It grew so much on me that the hair stopped growing on my head after that. But the point is that I'll just go back if you allow me. There is so much to be interpreted because everything is not... there's a lot of abstraction in the symbols that have been used in this. There have been so many stories. We are sitting here at the lake. Not the younger generation surely wouldn't know the story of this lake. There used to be a tree there used to be an island out there. There was a tree over there. That has gone there. There used to be at the bandstand. Used to have a Sunday, performance, and there used to be a regatta. The people tree over here. So every nook and corner of this and the facades of the capital complex, Corbusian concepts, have whole lot of symbology. There are enigmas which are to be unraveled, and I keep doing that. And so my coming to the answer
patta is, patta yeah. bolta hai, and Rajneesh is a great tree hugger. He has started this club, the Tree Lovers Club. You must tell us about that Rajneesh.
Yeah. And the other thing besides the architecture and the built form, the other great thing about the city is that it is the only city in the world which has a planned landscaping, or at least had one. And it's now not dwindling and things are not... But every tree that you see on the streets was actually designed. It's not there now anymore. But by and large still hold good. So we have a group of tree lovers who go around doing tree walks and all. The idea is that it may be a young city, I come back to that. But there is a thought behind, this must be the only city in the world where the manhole covers are being auctioned for Americans who want to pay $30,000 for. There is one right in front of my house. So this is, there is so much more. The short point is, there is so much more to understand about the young city, to explore its riches, which are probably not a little enigmatic, might be. It might be, there might be little abstractions. But if we, the citizens of Chandigarh are very curious and very bright and they are very keen also, they are custodians of the city. So, believe me, to put it very directly, I am happy doing the drum beating and my aspiration is to be the Raju guide of Chandigarh.
Oh, that's a very good objective. Why not throw everything into the bargain? Not a bad idea. Now, how do you take your city with you when you travel? Because I know you've been going places, you've been lecturing at different institutions across the globe. How do you take your city with you? What kind of talks do you give them? How do you make Chandigarh visible, so to speak?
See, I'll be honest that most of the talks are very much for the fellow architects or the academia, but also I give a lot of public lectures, and where then I simplify the narrative or give analogies which are a little more easier for let us say without the technical jargon. And you see, the city plan, for simple, it's just like a chessboard, and it's something, there's again a history to it. You know, most people know that Corbusier thing, that Corbusier planned it, but before Corbusier came on the scene, there was an American team which planned everything, but that never got executed. And therefore, you see, how in a story, there are many turns and acts of destiny, you know, acts of God. Just to allow me 1 minute to build up the interest. Before this city was built, there was already one Chandigarh. The railway station of Chandi Mandir, where, you know, which in the cantonment. In the 1947 record, we have a map out there. Wo station ka naam Chandigarh hai. Haan. Aur wo usko baad mein change kiya gaya. So there was one original native Chandigarh. Then the Americans came and planned a Chandigarh. There was an American Chandigarh. Then the French-Indian Corbusier thing made a Chandigarh. And now Badal Sahib has made a new Chandigarh. And this Chandigarh. So we have four Chandigarh coexisting, in the narrative of this city.
Is this history available anywhere online?
Yeah, it's there in the museum. We have published books. And so when you said that, what do you do? You carry the city. So I try to be a balladeer of the city. I do the drum beating. I try to bring the essence of this very young city, but full of thought and deep.
Sometimes in a relationship with somebody very dear, and in this case a city, there is sometimes an ambivalence. Do you find any ambivalence in your feelings towards the city? You know, there's certain things about it that you don't like, which you would like to rectify.
The city is a living organism, and we do not want to be protectors of the holy cow. The city is not only about one, big party for the family of architects and urban planners. You know, the city belongs to the citizens, and citizens make the city. Like, there is a very famous quote that fathers make cities, and cities make sons. So you see, the architecture is not the only spectacle going around in our city. Actually, the spectacle is provided by the people, the things they do, the festivals they hold. This literature festival, this lake, which is a very somnolent place, is so alive and abuzz for the last 2 days. It's the, this is the spectacle which brings life to the city. So it's a two-way process. The city is not meant to be frozen in time zone. But the point is, when there is a deep thought, and it is very precious. If you will go for the laissez-faire or the most populist thing and vote, put everything to vote, then we might end up ruining and killing the goose that lays the golden eggs. So no, it's a question of having a fine balance. You must protect, you must cherish, you must fiercely guard what is so preciously given to us. At the same time, do not get fossil.
You know, there was a time when Chandigarh was described famously as chittiyan daadiyan te hariyan jhaadiyan. But over the years, I think something has changed. What, according to you, has changed, Rajneesh? Chandigarh is now, I won't say middle-aged, but if you go by normal terms, well into senility. You know, in physical terms, if you talk about a woman, a human being, 60 plus is, old. So, in your opinion, how has Chandigarh aged over time?
I think it has grown younger and younger, quite frankly. while the veterans and the senior citizens have chosen it to be their home and they love it. And you know, it's the like, you know, the saying goes, to make room for the grandchild, you don't have to throw away the grandparents, you know, to make room for the baby. So the hallmark thing about the city is that it's a city of great achievers. Look at the large spectrum of achievers in every field, in sports, in you know, even in Bollywood, even in talent. There's so much of being achieved in the university, and so many centers of excellence in learning, your university and PGI, everything, you know. It's a city of a buzz with youthful energy and sports centers. So I think we are having the best of...
Tell us briefly about the books that you've written related to the city, Rajneesh.
Very briefly, it's again...
Rajneesh has been not just a teacher, but he's been writing also. And I'm saying it for the benefit of people who may have joined later. So he's written on the trees of Chandigarh. He's written a lot of medals. He's written articles on Chandigarh, the history, the architecture of Chandigarh, and so on. So what, tell us something about your writings, Rajneesh.
I hope I'm not boring, monopolizing.
No, please don't monopolize me now.
Raja, I hope you will not never come to the plains again. You're the Raja of the hills. There, we look at you every day.
We are going to move from the plains to the hills very soon.
Well, you know, it is basically, as I said, the chronicler, you know, it's more like acts of documenting and presenting them in a glossy cover. The idea was that, you know, I think at the session before that, someone said that if you're intensely moved and, you know, by something, I'm intentionally moved by my own city. And while I'm a product of the city and I'm a participant, I'm an organism of the city, I'm so deeply, you can say in a way, it's a passionate love affair. So I try to share that, those riches, and also, as I said, that few things are not, are in abstraction, are in thought, are in symbolism. So I try to connect, and don't forget, Chandigarh has a huge interest world, I mean, people in the world. The best thing about, it's not my biodata or whatever Manju nice thing she said. My address is the best thing when I go to any city or any university in the world. When the moment I say that I'm an architect for Chandigarh, all the doors open.
And they say, oh, Chandigarh, Chandigarh, that's the city made by Kabir here. That's what they say usually, don't they? So, Rajneesh, you are rooted. You are rooted to this place, and yet you've been able to go places. In fact, both our speakers today, they exemplify what we call roots and wings. They are rooted to the city that they belong to, and yet they have wings that take them abroad, take them around the world. But they have to come back. They have to come back home, because this is the place where they love. Rajneesh loves Chandigarh, and that's where he is. And Raja Bhaseen on my right. Raja Bhaseen is a name that we have been familiar with for a long time. He says, I'm never going to leave the hills. And the reason for not leaving the hills is, of course, his lovely wife who's in the audience. And also because, well, the hills have their own charm, they have their own magic, and they'll hold on to you. You know, there's a popular belief that if you belong to the hills will call you back. No matter where you are in the world, they will call you back. So we have Raja Bhaseen from Shimla, and he's also been a Chandigarh boy. He studied in Chandigarh. Unfortunately, we did not meet then, Raja.
So, I think there was a little bit of a time lag in the period when you were there and I was there.
Yeah, I belong to an older generation.
Not really.
So, Raja is from Shimla. And Raja, before I ask you to say something, may I recite a poem about Shimla? Yeah? Because Shimla is very dear to me also. There's a little poem. With her eyes so wide and her brow so clear. This is Shimla. Shimla being described. With her eyes so wide and her brow so clear, she was a queen, so very pristine, clear and chaste and virginal, her beauty so fresh and original, exuding a wealth of cheer and good health, fragrance and radiance and a splash of blue green and flaming rhododendrons in abundance. A relief from the heat, a refuge so sweet, a shelter and escape, an alluring landscape, twinkling at night with many a splendid light, hers the beauty of starry skies, a haven of peace, a sight for sore eyes. And from this haven of light, from this haven of beauty, comes Raja Bhaseen. He's come down here with his stories about Shimla. My acquaintance with Raja Bhaseen is mainly through his books. I met him for the first time, but I did go through his books, and of course he's a well-known name. If you go to Shimla, of course you have to see Candlepoint, you have to see the church, and you have to see books on Shimla by Raja Bhaseen. So put that on your itinerary. Yeah. So Raja, tell us about your works, please. Raja Bhaseen.
Thank you. Am I audible at the back? I really don't know how to begin this one. But well, the first book which I did was on my hometown, Shimla. Shimla as it's written and pronounced now. And there have been some people who've been a little tempted to alter that even further. But we shall let that ride for the moment. If one was to look for a story, Rajneesh was able to find and perhaps create a story starting from the brilliant Matthew Noviki, coming to Corbusier, coming to you. I've had a long connection with this city also. I was born here. The family was constantly shuttling between Shimla and Chandigarh. In fact, much of Chandigarh was born in Shimla for the one simple reason that at that point of time, once Lahore was gone, it was Shimla that was the capital of the Punjab government. And the Punjab government, many of the things, the decisions which affected the city, which created the city, were actually taken in Shimla or in Delhi. And Corbusier spent a fair amount of time living up in the hills, sort of mulling over what he would be doing when he came down to the plains. So of course, he said famously that I can design the city sitting in my atelier in Paris. Fortunately, that didn't happen. If one was to look at the city, a cityscape, Shimla is an extraordinary cityscape. It's an extraordinary city. Nothing of a similar nature exists anywhere in the world. In a manner of speaking, a completely artificial city that has become an extremely real city. It is a city that perhaps had no reason to come into being at all. The two major concepts which were introduced by the British in our country as urban concepts, the concept of the hill station and the concept of the cantonment, were really absent in those years gone by. Our story of this town also begins in a very strange way. It begins in an extremely unusual way, and it goes back is to the great money-grubbing company, the East India Company, the world's original blood-sucking company. It goes back to the time we have this thing in our heads that the East India Company traded. Initially it traded, but as the years went on, it was not trade, it was taxes which gave the company its revenue, the Diwani of Bengal being the core source of revenue for the East India Company. A second major source of money for the East India Company was opium. Opium grown in India, shipped into China, and the sale of opium generated the bullion, which was finally transferred across to Britain. A third major source of revenue for the East India Company was indigo. It was the extract from the Indian indigo plant, the common, which is something like a common pea, the matar ka pauda. It's the same family. It's the extract from that which was taken out, gave us this deep blue, which was dried into cakes, shipped to Britain. That is what dyed the uniforms of the Royal Navy, the first navy in the world to have a uniform. It came from Indian indigo. Now our story jumps in different ways when we want to make the connections. Our story, in a manner of speaking, begins down in Rajasthan, where this man Dravya Shah, who claimed to be a nobleman from Rajasthan, lost his kingdom to the expansion of Mughal rule. He moved north to the foothills of Nepal and took sanctuary with this holy man, Sant Gorakhnath. Gorakhnath is supposed to have blessed him that 11 of your generations will rule this area. We people from the East, all of us Indians, we love our little mumbo jumbo. We love our stories, our curses, our blessings. Be that as it may, King Gyanendra Shah of Nepal, who was deposed 9 or 10 years ago, was the 11th. So there just might be some people. Anyway, it was Drabya Shah and his grandson Prithvi Narayan Shah who started bringing together the different small tribes and kingdoms of Nepal. In this coming together, the level of aggression in Nepal went up dramatically. This is a timeless pattern. Whenever newfound nations start forming, they start creating an identity for themselves, more often than not, they end up becoming aggressive and outward looking. Cases in point, which we are more familiar with, pre-Bismarck, post-Bismarck Germany. When Bismarck started bringing together the different Germanic people, the level of aggression in Germany went up dramatically.
So, it was Rajat, at least one of the you've been causes. Writing about all this, yes. But can we focus on your books on Shimla?
This is what I'm coming to, mm-hmm. Where the story really originates.
Right.
The story originates is when the people of Nepal, with this aggression, left the borders of Nepal and covered and invaded and took over all of present-day Uttaranchal, all of present-day Himachal Pradesh, and the invasion touched Ropard in the Punjab. In the hills, every single one of the local rulers lost his kingdom. These local rulers turned to the East India Company for help. The East India Company wasn't here to help anyone. It was here to make money. There was no profit to be made. But
thank you. And I must thank my old friend Rajneesh and my newfound friend Raja Bhaseen for a session. And of course the audience, thank you so much. You've been so attentive. And in fact, at the end of the day, we thought you'd be yawning or you wouldn't be there at all. But you are here and we really appreciate it. Thank you so much for being a wonderful audience.
That's the mark of Shimla. But lately, for the last few years, especially this year, Shimla has become very famous for its water crisis. Measures are the locals and the government and the administration taking?
Well, the question is Shimla's water crisis. It's a perpetual question. It's been there for the last 50 years, if not longer. This year it went really out of hand. I am not in a position to speak on behalf of any administration. But yes, I can definitely share this with you. We were without water for 10 days. But I believe that this issue is now finally on the verge of being sorted out, because this new dam, the coal dam, which is over the river Satluj, the pumping scheme is going to start functional, can become functional in another year and a half or so. So Shimla supposedly will have 24 hours of flowing water.
One last question from the gentleman. Yes, where are you?
I am Raja Bhaseen. I want to know one thing. I have seen you in Shimla many times. I studied in Bishop Cotton School.
My old school, sir.
So I know. Somebody told me that he is also studying in Bishop Cotton School. But whenever I wanted to talk to you about things, you know, because I studied many, much, much earlier. You hadn't been born probably by then. But anyway, so you didn't give much lift, you know.
Sir.
Okay, now you are already on the top of the world. Raja, because there were lots of class friends of mine who were busy.
We keep coming out of the woodwork.
Thank you, sir.
where do you live in Shimla?
Where do you live in
town,
Shimla?
Sir. The next time you are there, please join me for a drink at home.
Nee, which place?
We are in town, so the heart of Shimla, sir.
Jaga batao na.
Sir, I'll give you
aapke
my
answer. Dil mein rehte hain, ji.
With that,
thank you to both the speakers, Rajneesh and Raja. It's a pleasure talking on this stage with you. And thank you very much. Have a wonderful evening.